The title of my paper is Salvator Mundi, Three Types of Christology. I once tried offering a course at Princeton Seminary called Salvator Mundi, and very few students signed up, I mean, even fewer than I usually get. And I started asking some MDiv students, why is this? What's going on? He said, well, a lot of students have never heard of a theologian named Salvator Mundi. In a little noticed passage from his book, The Christian Faith, Friedrich Schleiermacher, the great 19th century theologian and father of modern liberal theology, introduces an interesting set of distinctions. His own Christology, he suggests, can be differentiated from two other approaches, which he labels as the empirical and the magical. After an initial hesitation, he designates his own view by the term mystical. The mystical view, he says, stands midway between the other two. They are all distinguished in part by how they see the natural in relation to the supernatural. The empirical view is said to be entirely naturalistic, while the magical view is entirely supernaturalistic. The mystical view is then brought forward to mediate between these two positions. Here, Schleiermacher introduces his famous thesis that although God's activity in history is certainly supernatural in origin, it becomes natural, he says, as soon as it emerges into manifestation. In a move that would become seminal for modern liberal theology, Schleiermacher wants to naturalize the supernatural without eliminating it completely. The three views he describes can be sketched as follows. The empirical view. The empirical view, Schleiermacher says, is essentially individualistic. Empirical Christology affirms Christ's redeeming influence, an important category for Schleiermacher, but sees it as operating directly upon the individual. The written word is sometimes regarded as mediating this influence, while at other times even that is dispensed with. For Schleiermacher, the empirical view is defective at this point because it fails to grasp how Christ is related to the church. It overlooks his founding of a community to mediate his redeeming influence. In the empirical view, Christ's significance is basically reduced to his teaching and example, which are supposed to bring about an increasing perfection in us. Nevertheless, as the empirical view admits, even if his teaching and example are thought to be perfect in themselves, they fail to bring about perfection in us. According to Schleiermacher, empirical Christology thus lacks the idea of redemption in the proper sense, which involves the removal of sin. Furthermore, this Christology cannot quiet our uneasy consciences except by appealing to the divine compassion, which is believed to be available, Schleiermacher remarks dryly, even apart from Christ. For Schleiermacher, Christ must be seen as more than a teacher and example. He must be seen as redeeming us from sin. In favor of empirical Christology, according to Schleiermacher, it can be said that it relieves us of the anxiety of feeling that we must offer God substitutes for the perfection that we lack in his sight. This anxiety is seen as a pervasive phenomenon in religion. But then Schleiermacher continues, we already knew by our natural intelligence that the attempt to satisfy God through the offering of sacrifices, as for example a spotless lamb, is futile. The contribution of the empirical view is therefore negligible at this point. Schleiermacher agrees with the empirical view in rejecting substitutionary atonement. In line with much modern theology, he thinks it makes no rational sense. Schleiermacher emphasizes that empirical Christology is ethical in orientation. In this view, the relation between teacher and pupil, like that between pattern and imitation, must always, he says, remain an external one. Schleiermacher is saying that a merely ethical Christology establishes a merely external relation to Christ. According to him, when those who advocate an ethical Christology are asked whether they have known a real experience of vital fellowship with Christ, they tend to recoil, feeling that they are being pushed toward the objectionable magic view. It is telling that an ethical Christology is content to separate the teachings of Christ from teachings about Christ, as if his person were of secondary importance. Schleiermacher, who thinks that the person of Christ is of primary importance, clearly wants to expand the range of options at this point beyond just the empirical and the magical. For an ethical or empirical Christology, as Schleiermacher presents it, nothing more is needed to understand Christ than, quote, some improvements upon natural ethics and natural theology, as these improvements are represented as if human reason must have found them out by itself. Schleiermacher concludes that the empirical view is chiefly to blame for the claim of philosophy to set itself above faith and to treat faith as merely a transitional stage. While Schleiermacher is certainly willing to criticize the magical Christology from a rational standpoint, he does not want reason to dominate faith as much as he thinks it does in empirical Christology. Although he would have had more than one opponent in mind, Schleiermacher seems to associate the empirical view largely with Kant. By extension, Schleiermacher's critical observations would apply more generally to what we sometimes think of today as exemplarist Christologies, the magical view. At the other extreme is the magical view, which Schleiermacher finds equally dubious, if not more so. Whereas empirical Christology was naturalistic and individualistic, the magical view is flawed by being supernatural and objectivist. According to magical Christology, the meaning of Christ's saving significance can be defined without referring to our vital fellowship with him. Redemption is seen as an objective transaction between God and Christ that occurred when he died for our sins. This means, Schleiermacher explains, that the forgiveness of sins is made to depend upon the punishment which Christ suffered. Redemption is presented as a reward which God offers to Christ for the suffering of that punishment. An objective efficacy is ascribed to the cross, so that vital fellowship with Christ becomes merely secondary and derivative. For Schleiermacher, union with Christ is experiential, and experiential religion defines what is central to Christology. Although Schleiermacher does not find this Christology to be wrong in every respect, he argues that blessedness and forgiveness become magical when they are not seen as mediated through vital fellowship with Christ. Apart from this fellowship, God's rewarding of Christ is, he says, nothing but divine arbitrariness. If salvation were truly accomplished apart from us, externos, without any inner basis within us, in nobis, then salvation would lack its decisive component. It would be worked out apart from our spiritual experience of it. The source of blessedness would be established objectively rather than within us. Salvation as objectively accomplished could only be infused into each individual from without. For Schleiermacher, the objective aspect of salvation is important only insofar as it serves as the source of the subjective aspect. What takes place in Christ apart from us, his spiritual blessedness, is only the prologue to what takes place within us, our spiritual formation through the experience of his blessedness. The subjective aspect is central while the objective aspect merely facilitates it. Forgiveness of sins is also magically conceived if thought to occur apart from our experience of it. When forgiveness is established objectively, the dynamics of salvation become implausible. The consciousness of deserving punishment is supposed to cease, observes Schleiermacher, because the punishment has been borne by another. Schleiermacher wants sin consciousness to cease, but not for that reason, which he regards as far-fetched. For him, as for modern liberal theology more generally, all ideas of objective atonement must be rejected as magical. Reconciliation either happens within us, or it does not happen at all. Magical Christology is also wrong to suppose that the decisive experience of vital fellowship with Christ would not be possible if Christ had not suffered and died for us. It sees Christ's saving death as that which makes possible our fellowship with him. It regards the real sum total of Christ's redemptive activity, Schleiermacher suggests, as his giving up of himself to suffering for suffering's sake. For Schleiermacher, what magical Christology fails to grasp is that Christ's inward spiritual blessedness is independent of his passion and death. Whereas for the magical caricature, his passion and death serve to constitute his saving significance. In fact, according to Schleiermacher, they only confirm it. Christ's passion and death are merely tests of his spiritual blessedness, not factors that constitute it. For Schleiermacher, the cross is an ordeal, not a satisfaction for sin. Finally, the magical view mistakenly holds that Christ's obedience is our righteousness, quoting him here, or that his righteousness is imputed to us. These ideas, again, wrongly posit that Christ's saving significance rests on what he accomplished externally to us, whereas in fact, it rests on his influence within us. The fundamental mistake is to think that the punishment of sin is taken away through the suffering of Christ. In his passion and death, the Redeemer had borne, if in his passion and death, the Redeemer had borne the punishment for sin that would otherwise have befallen the world, then Schleiermacher concludes, it is scarcely possible to avoid the supplementary assumption that the divine nature in him also shared in the suffering. But according to established tradition, Schleiermacher argues, the idea that God suffers is absurd. It seems that Schleiermacher's Christology tends toward Nestorianism by separating the divine nature in Christ from his human suffering. Furthermore, the magical view, according to Schleiermacher, rests on a crude idea of divine wrath. Only by positing that God must punish sin by his wrath can the magical view teach that sin's punishment was transferred from us to Christ. It fails to see that if sin is to be decisively overcome, it can only be overcome within us, not outside of us. In rejecting the magical view, Schleiermacher's key opponent seems to be Anselm, or at least some version of Anselm. As a matter of fact, although the medieval theologian had taught that punishment and satisfaction were mutually exclusive, he was commonly misunderstood in post-Reformation Protestant theology. He was taken to mean that the divine wrath was satisfied through Christ being punished in our stead. In Cur Deus Homo, however, Anselm had seen the sacrifice on the cross as compensating God for the injury done to his honor by sin. The idea of Christ dying in our place played no role in his argument. Nevertheless, it was not uncommon for later Protestant theologians to read the idea of substitution into Anselm. The magical Christology described and rejected by Schleiermacher would have been broadly Anselmian in that sense. What Anselm and the later Protestant view of satisfaction had in common was a more objectivist understanding of Christ's saving death, the mystical view. Although we will return to Schleiermacher's views in a moment, a preliminary sketch of his Christological alternative can be offered here. He sees his mystical view of salvation as neither ethical nor magical, because it centers on the spirituality of inwardness. It is the spirituality of Christ, which Schleiermacher calls his blessedness, that carries his saving significance. The Redeemer's blessedness is the source of all true spiritual formation. It creates a spiritual community, and through this community, his blessedness is mediated to each believer. His blessedness is the objective aspect that then becomes subjective in us. In a state of spiritual blessedness, the believer experiences salvation in Christ. The power of sin is broken. God consciousness replaces God forgetfulness. Fellowship with Christ's blessedness is enjoyed. A central ethical imperative is to promote this blessedness in oneself and in others. For Schleiermacher, ethics, though not unimportant, is secondary to spirituality. Moreover, what takes place within us, in nobis, depends in some sense on what has taken place apart from us, extra nos, and to that extent, the magical view is not wrong. However, what took place apart from us is not satisfaction, but the spirituality of Jesus. His blessedness becomes available to us through the Word, received, preserved, and transmitted by his community. The Word contains, says Schleiermacher, the picture of his being and influence through which his spiritual presence is mediated. As we enter into fellowship with his presence or blessedness, we undergo the spiritual renewal that constitutes the meaning of redemption. Redemption takes place as the blessedness of Jesus himself is communicated to those who enjoy fellowship with him by faith. Low, middle, and high, revising Schleiermacher's typology. Schleiermacher's typology contains both analytical and evaluative elements. It will be useful to place the evaluative elements to one side while expanding on those that are analytical. The terms empirical, mystical, and magical, after all, are largely uninformative and tendentious. I propose to replace them with the more neutral terms of low, middle, and high. An immediate advantage of this move is to broaden the field of discernment. As Schleiermacher saw in his own way, by introducing the category of middle Christology, it becomes possible to avoid the pitfall that all Christologies must be either low or high. A recent article on Schleiermacher, for example, proposes quite implausibly that he represents a high Christology. High in this proposal effectively means not low, apparently because there are no other known options. While it is correct that Schleiermacher's Christology is not low in any exemplarist sense, it is not high either in any reasonable sense of the term. It is rather a middle Christology, as his own typology helps to make clear. His typology also helps us to see that a rather large and diverse group of modern Christologies exists whose representatives are neither low nor high. Despite the diversity within this group, its members display the lineaments of a middle Christology. Let me begin with some general remarks about my typological proposal. One, the first thing to see about the low, middle, and high types is that they are not like points on a line. They are not like little dots that one either occupies or fails to occupy. They are rather more like regions within which one can take up residence. The regions will embrace a certain degree of diversity. Nevertheless, family resemblances will exist within one region that will not be found in another. A citizen of France might live near Belgium or the Netherlands while still being a citizen of France. Two, the second thing to see is that the types are not linear in relation to one another. If one imagines two bricks sitting side by side, with a third brick sitting on top at the midpoint, one can form a better idea of how the types are related when taken as regions. Views that reside near the contiguous borders may sometimes have more in common with views across the border than those removed to the far corners. In the regions of France near Belgium or the Netherlands, the French language might not be spoken as purely as it would be in Paris. Whether that is an advantage or a disadvantage would depend on the circumstances. Three, the third thing to see about the types is that they are not necessarily mutually exclusive at every point. A low Christology removed to a far corner might not include any middle or high elements, but one closer to the contiguous borders might still be low while also being a little mixed. A middle Christology that excluded all ethical elements would not be as compelling as one that took ethics on board. Much the same would be true for high Christology. A high Christology that allowed ample scope to spirituality and ethics would be stronger than one that lacked those elements. Four, the fourth thing to see about this proposed typology is that it allows us to think about each type in its strongest terms. It is not uncommon for those who develop a Christology within one region to reject a more defective Christology from another region, and then suppose that the whole region has been effectively dealt with. Schleiermacher's treatment of magical Christology is arguably a case in point. The magical view that he rejects does not necessarily represent high Christology at its best. Although he probably would have rejected any high Christology, the discussion would have been improved if he had made an effort to avoid caricaturing his opponents. Schleiermacher does not seem to have noticed any high Christologies in a stronger form. Otherwise, he might not have dismissed them so facilely with his term magical. Five, finally, and this cannot be stressed strongly enough, any actually existing Christology may not belong perfectly to one of these regions alone. The terms low, middle, and high represent something like ideal types, not necessarily actual positions. Some Christologies may travel back and forth across the borders, depending on the question. My types are meant to be used analytically, not predictively or rigidly. They are categories of discernment, not useful pots to put things in. If there are any Winnie the Pooh fans here, I hope you catch the allusion. It does not matter if a particular Christology fails to fit perfectly into one of them, one of the pots. What matters is that the ideal types can help us to see why not. The typology can also help us to discern whether anomalies may happen to exist in certain mixed Christologies. Mixed Christologies are not always internally coherent. Furthermore, as mentioned, this typology can help us to sort out stronger versions from weaker versions within one of the Christological regions. Some formal issues and their development. Some formal issues will now be outlined that any Christology must address. How the three types tend to deal with these issues will also be sketched. With that as background, we will turn our attention to some actually existing Christologies from each ideal type. the person and work of Christ. The first formal issue pertains to Christ's person and his saving work. How are these terms defined, and how are they thought to be related? The issue can be stated in algebraic form. Let P stand for Christ's person, and W for his saving work. For any Christology, we can posit the following: if P, then W, and if W, then P. These formulas assume that the Christology is internally coherent, which is not always the case. As a general rule, however, it is true that a certain sort of saving work requires a certain view of Christ's person. The reverse is also true. A certain view of Christ's person points to a particular understanding of his saving significance. This simple observation already places us in a position to see something important. Only a high view of Christ's saving work requires a high view of the incarnation, or a Chalcedonian view of his person. Low and middle views of his work can dispense with Chalcedon, and often do, although there are notable exceptions. They can dispense with it because of how they understand Christ's saving significance. Only a high view of the atonement requires a Chalcedonian view of Christ's person. For low Christologies, as Schleiermacher pointed out, Christ has saving significance primarily as a religious teacher and a moral example. His life and teaching put forward an elevated religious and ethical content. Christ teaches us about God's love and forgiveness, and his teaching is exemplified by his life. He saves us from our ignorance, and at least in some low Christologies, his Spirit assists us in our weakness. Salvation takes place through the imitation of Christ, which requires our repentance as we strive to emulate his way of life. If this kind of teaching and example constitute Christ's saving work, W, he does not need to be God incarnate, P. He does not need to be fully God and fully human in one person. He merely needs to be fully human. Examples of Christology are not unknown, however, in which a high view of Christ's person is somehow combined with an essentially low view of his work. This is the kind of anomaly that the typology can help us to pick out. Some Latin American liberation theologians, for example, such as Gustavo Gutierrez or Juan Sobrino, seem to combine a high view of Christ's person with a low or ethical liberationist understanding of his saving work. Other low Christologies have suggested that we might look on Jesus as the parable of God. However well-intentioned, such proposals are Arian in tendency, offering a low view of Christ's person, whereby he is defined as less than fully God, no matter how much he may be like God. As a matter of fact, for a typical low Christology, Jesus does not need to be anything more than a gifted and exemplary human being. He can do his saving, ethical, or religious work without being fully God. All he needs to be is fully human. Schleiermacher is right that low Christology place Christ and his followers in an essentially external relation. For middle Christologies, the saving significance of Christ is defined by his spirituality. For those that use traditional categories, the important thing about Jesus is the Holy Spirit. An example would be the Dutch theologian Hendrikus Berkhof. In other modern Christologies, we encounter essentially the same idea in different, more flashy terms. The important thing about Jesus might be his God consciousness with Schleiermacher, or the new being with Tillich, or simply faith with Bultmann, or loyalty to God with H. Richard Niebuhr. Whereas for Berkhof, Jesus is the bearer and the sender of the Spirit. For these others, he is the bearer and the sender of God consciousness, the new being, or some other form of life-giving spirituality. In all cases, Jesus is the source of some saving benefit other than himself, unless his person is just absorbed into his spirituality, as happens with Schleiermacher. Jesus is the source and the means to a redemptive spirituality, which is thought to be liberating, empowering, or transforming, mostly at the level of inwardness. No matter how hard a middle Christology may try, justification always blurs into sanctification. The important thing about Jesus is his spirituality, he does not need to be fully God. He merely needs to be a fully realized spiritual human being. He merely needs to be as with Schleiermacher, the second Adam, who overcomes the disastrous consequences of the first Adam, whose fall dragged us all into sin and death. Christ's saving work consists in his restoring a spiritual relation to God, first in his own case, and then through his influence in others after him. While weak versions of middle Christology might tend to be quietist and pietistic, stronger versions will incorporate a more robust ethical element. Middle Christologies, however, tend to be indifferent or hostile toward Nicaea and Chalcedon. Why shouldn't they be, if the whole point of Christ is merely a matter of spirituality? Only a high Christology requires a high view of Christ's person, because only a high Christology takes a high view of his saving work. Generally speaking, there are two broad reasons for affirming the full deity of Jesus Christ. The first is hermeneutical, while the other is soteriological. The hermeneutical reason is that the New Testament documents bear witness to Jesus as God. He is not only described as God, he is also depicted as God. We see him not only designated with the term theos, but also doing things that only God can do, such as forgiving sins and raising the dead. The doctrinal reason, on the other hand, which is essentially threefold, overlaps with the hermeneutical reason. Doctrinally, the focus falls on worship, revelation, and reconciliation, a point that is well brought out in question 33 of the New Presbyterian Study Catechism. Question 33, what is the significance of affirming that Jesus is truly God? Answer, only God can properly deserve worship, only God can reveal to us who God is, and only God can save us from our sins. Being truly God, Jesus meets these conditions. He is the proper object of our worship, the self-revelation of God, and the Savior of the world. Low and middle Christologies usually dispense with presenting Jesus as the proper object of worship and prayer. From a high Christological standpoint, neither a low Christology, such as we find in someone like John Locke, or in a very emaciated version today in someone like Marcus Borg, nor a middle Christology, such as we find in the likes of Schleiermacher, Tillich, Bultmann, or H. Richard Niebuhr, is satisfactory on this score. None has any real place for Jesus as the object of worship. High Christologies, such as we find in Florovsky, von Balthasar, and Barth, to mention only three of the most distinguished, affirm Jesus as the object of worship. And I do mean Jesus. Precisely because they affirm Jesus as Lord. In this sense, high Christologies are truly ecclesial Christologies in a way that low and middle Christologies are not. For high Christologies, it is not Jesus who is important because of the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit who is important because of Jesus. It is the Holy Spirit who bears witness to Jesus and his unique saving work, and not the reverse. The Spirit does not become incarnate and die for our sins. The Spirit rather attests Jesus for who he is, as the mystery of Christmas, which is the mystery of God with us in human flesh. Through word and sacrament, the Spirit brings Christ to us and us to Christ, that he might give us his very self as the one who died that we might live. A strong version of high Christology would incorporate a significant element of spirituality and ethics. Here, much work remains to be done. While Bart is strong on reconciliation and revelation, as well as on ethics, including progressive politics and Christian missions, he is less so on worship, especially Eucharistic worship, and even less so on matters of spirituality, to which he had an allergic reaction. A momentous task would be to combine Bart with the best of Jonathan Edwards and Alexander Schmemann, with a strong dose of Gustavo Gutierrez thrown in. Florovsky and Balthazar are strong on Christology, spirituality, and worship, but much less so on mission and ethics. Nevertheless, for high Christologies, Christ is not just the source of some saving benefits other than himself, whether they be ethical or spiritual or both. As Thomas F. Torrance has especially made clear, Christ's person is inseparable from his saving work, as well as from his saving benefits. His person, his work, and his benefits are indivisibly one, so that none can be had without the others. Only a person of Christ, who is fully God and fully human, can have this high saving significance. Only he can be the object of worship, the self-revelation of God, and the Savior of the world. If W, then P, and if P, then W. Salvation has three tenses. Low, middle, and high Christologies differ on how they understand the three tenses of salvation. Asking about them is always a good diagnostic tool. How are the three tenses of salvation defined in any given Christology, and how are they thought to be related? Which aspects of salvation are thought to take place in the past tense, the present tense, and the future tense? Which tense, if any, provides the decisive locus of salvation? Low and middle Christologies are strongly oriented toward the present tense. The present tense for them is the decisive locus of salvation. The past is prologue, and the future is determined by what happens in the present. Salvation either takes place in the present tense, or it does not take place at all. For low Christologies, the salvation event is the ethical event, even when the ethical event is religiously motivated. These Christologies do not usually have a strong view of human bondage to sin. They tend to be relatively optimistic about unaided human capabilities. The future tense of salvation, often conceived in terms of immortality, is thought to depend on a person's ethical performance in the present. Salvation is an ethical process, which tends to be conceived in mildly or blatantly Pelagian terms. Low Christologies, with their strong emphasis on the necessity of human effort, are not always sympathetic to the idea of universal salvation. John Locke, Albrecht Ritschl, and Juan Luis Segundo would be examples, each in his own way. Locke leaned toward annihilationism. Ritschl remained open to the possibility of eternal damnation for the recalcitrant, and Segundo regarded hell as a limit concept, a pole, not a place, indicating the sad fate of human action if it does not take into account the life of the neighbor. For middle Christologies, the present tense is again the privileged tense of salvation. The spirituality of Jesus, however it may be conceived, was forged in the past so that it can be communicated and become effectual in the present. The sanctification experienced through our receiving Christ's spirituality in order to be transformed by it is what determines the quality of salvation's future tense. Sin is seen mainly as an enslaving power, rather than as violating the moral law, the low view, or as rebellion against God, the high view. Sin's influence is broken in the present as one appropriates Christ's potent spirituality. Schleiermacher relies on a doctrine of predestination to argue that universal salvation may be probable, but he is perplexed about how or even whether it will occur. Will it be the result of a gradual process, or will it occur suddenly with the return of Christ? How might all persons come to receive a share in the spiritual blessedness of Christ, since for any given person, its appropriation is what sways the future? Tillich teaches the idea of universal essentialization, according to which all creatures, whether human or non-human, are potentially included in final salvation. Estrangement from God, as opposed to enmity of God against God, dominates his doctrine of sin. The power of the new being in Jesus as the Christ conquers estrangement in the midst of our universal brokenness. It does so first in the case of Jesus himself, and then for all those who receive his power in the present. It also breaks the power as mediated by the picture of Jesus as the Christ. How the possibility of universal salvation is supposed to relate to those who do not receive this power through him remains unclear. It would seem logically possible, and perhaps more internally consistent, for middle Christologies to deny a final salvation for those who are not transformed by Jesus' spirituality in this life. High Christologies may or may not teach universal salvation, but in recent times, they have tended to leave the question open in hope. Metropolitan Callistus Ware among the Eastern Orthodox, Hans Urs von Balthasar among the Roman Catholics, and T.F. Torrance among the Reformed have all refused to teach definitively that some, or perhaps very many, will not be saved. They hold out a hope that in the end, grace will find a way to triumph over sin even in the most hopeless of cases. In varying ways, such high Christologies differ from low and middle Christologies by placing more emphasis on Christ's finished work on the cross. The cross itself constitutes the decisive locus of salvation. Jesus Christ himself, crucified and risen, is then mediated into the present by the power of the Holy Spirit, especially through preaching and the Eucharist. Salvation, as it occurs here and now, is a secondary and dependent form of the one salvation accomplished on Calvary there and then. By the same token, the present tense form of salvation anticipates what salvation will mean in the future in its final and unsurpassable form. The Eucharist, as experienced here and now, for example, may be seen as provisionally anticipating the marriage feast of the Lamb in the age to come. Broadly speaking, we may say that for high Christologies, what took place on the cross as the culmination of Christ's vicarious obedience is definitive and constitutive. What takes place here and now through word and sacrament celebrates with thanksgiving the gift of the past while also anticipating what is yet to come. Finally, the promised future will bring one and the same salvation as accomplished by the Lord Jesus Christ for the sake of the world in its final, glorious, and unsurpassable form. How does salvation take place? In summary, we may say that salvation takes place for a low Christology by imitation. for a middle Christology by repetition, and for a high Christology by expiation. Low Christology is an exemplarist Christology, whereby salvation takes place through the imitation of Christ. All strong Christologies will need to incorporate this ethical element, but for a low Christology, imitatio Christi is not only imperative, but sufficient. As Schleiermacher rightly observed, this Christology sets up an essentially external relationship between Christ and his followers. Middle Christology is a Christology of spirituality, whereby salvation takes place by repetition. The spirituality achieved by Jesus needs to be repeated in those who receive him, which means in those who enter into union with him or who receive his saving power by faith. The basic movement is from possibility to actuality. What middle Christology preaches is new possibilities. It preaches that the spirituality of Jesus can be repeated in us. That is why Jesus serves as the prologue to salvation, as it occurs in the present. Unless the spirituality that was in him is repeated in us, salvation does not take place. While a high Christology would not need to reject this idea entirely, it could not make it central. A high Christology regards salvation as a perfect, finished, and unrepeatable event. It is a finished work that took place on Calvary apart from us. It does not need to be repeated, nor could it possibly be repeated. It comes to us as a pure gift. It needs to be acknowledged, received, partaken of, and confessed. But the one thing it cannot be is repeated. To try to repeat the unrepeatable would be the height of folly. Because grace is new each morning, salvation in Christ makes itself present in ever new forms, while always remaining essentially the same. The expiation of sin on the cross and the accompanying defeat of death by death are Christ's gift of himself to us. He takes our sin and death to himself and gives us his righteousness and life. He breaks the power of sin because he has done something that we most needed, but that only he himself could do. He has borne the terrible consequences of our guilt before God, and in his person he has borne them away. Having made himself one with us in his death, he now makes us one with himself in new life. A high Christology preaches actualities and not mere possibilities. It moves from the indicative to the imperative. It shows us how much God has loved us in Christ by pointing us to the cross, the indicative, and on that basis calls us to repent and believe, the imperative. High Christologies therefore represent a break, not only with the cruelty of moralism, but also with the tragic delusion of salvation by spirituality. For a high Christology, what salvation in Christ means, if it is to take place at all, is the justification of the godless and the resurrection of the dead. What is the status of Jesus Christ? For a low Christology, Jesus Christ is exemplary but not unique. For a middle Christology, he is unique, but not exclusively unique. And finally, for a high Christology, he is not just unique, but exclusively unique because he is unique in kind. We can elucidate these points by asking two more questions. Is Jesus Christ materially decisive for salvation? And is he logically indispensable to it? Generally speaking, for a low Christology, Jesus Christ is neither morally decisive, materially decisive, neither materially decisive nor logically indispensable. What is materially decisive are his religious and moral teachings. He may be a supreme example of them, but he is not logically indispensable because the teachings and their enactment could exist without him. That is what Schleiermacher had in mind when he remarked that low Christologies tend to give us little more than natural ethics and natural theology as derived from reason alone. As suggested by Kant, Jesus functions in these Christologies mainly as a moral symbol. For a middle Christology, Jesus is materially decisive, but not logically indispensable. He is materially decisive because the spirituality he communicates to others first needed to be achieved in his own life. But he is not logically indispensable because there is no good reason why the same sort of spirituality might not be achieved and transmitted by another. Schleiermacher is the great exception here, because he made Jesus logically indispensable by grounding his identity as the second Adam in the virgin birth. Modern liberal Christology almost never followed him in this move, however. One of Tillich's most sympathetic interpreters, for example, wrote an essay wondering whether for Tillich, Jesus was necessary for Christology, by which it was meant whether he was necessary for salvation as grounded in the spirituality of the new being. The answer was a hesitant no. If Jesus is merely a means to the end of spirituality, then spirituality is more important than Jesus, and his spirituality is where, and spirituality is where you find it. For a high Christology, Jesus is both materially decisive and logically indispensable. Since no one else will ever be God incarnate, he is logically indispensable. And since no one else will ever die for the sins of the world, he is materially decisive. For high Christologies, Jesus is an exclusively unique person who accomplished an exclusively unique work. Finally, how is the cross understood? The last formal issue to be mentioned is the saving significance of the cross. This is another diagnostic question of great illuminating power. Low, middle, and high Christologies differentiate themselves by the significance they ascribe to the cross. For a low Christology, the cross is exemplary in status. It shows that Jesus was both extremely noble and self-consistent because he was willing to die for his ideals. Low Christologies are therefore sometimes developed as martyr Christologies. For a middle Christology, the cross is understood as an ordeal. It shows that even in extremis, Jesus maintained his spiritual connection with God. As Tillich put it, he remained transparent to the ground of his being. For Tillich, he sacrificed himself as Jesus, as a mere particular person, to himself as the Christ, to his spiritual office as the bearer of the new being. For Schleiermacher, on the other hand, as we have seen, the cross is not really necessary to Jesus' saving significance. His God consciousness was severely tested by it, but it was already everything that it needed to be without it. The idea of the cross as a spiritual ordeal has ancient roots in Theodore of Mopsuestia and the Antiochene school of Christology. Finally, for a high Christology, Jesus did something for us by his death that his life could not have accomplished without it. As we have seen for this view, the cross is the site of the world's reconciliation with God. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. He made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. I do not know how to understand these New Testament verses and those like them, apart from the ideas of expiation, substitution, participation, and exchange. Expiation, because he bore our sin and bore it away. Substitution, because he died in our place that we might live. Participation, because it is only in union with him by grace through faith that we are made to be righteous in God's sight. And finally, exchange, because he took our desperate plight to himself and gave us his righteousness and life. Only a high Christology can make these biblical affirmations, because only a high Christology sees Jesus as fully God and fully human in one and the same person, without separation or division, and without confusion or change. Any different view of his person, as modern theologies amply attest, will give us a very different view of his saving work. The high mystery of our salvation from sin and death depends entirely on the high mystery of Christ. Thank you. Well, I'm on my own here fielding questions, but you're invited to form a line if you have questions to ask and come to the mic here.
So my question is both a Trinitarian and Johannine. That's the question of the role of Jesus and the Father. There's a sense in which John says that Jesus has come to exegete the Father, and Jesus says, you know, through him we come to the Father. And so in everything you've said, there's a Jesus spirit function there, but the question, how within your three positions does this role of Jesus as one who comes to bring us to not just a knowledge about the Father, but something that we might call beyond just justification as an act that's separate from us, but for us, or the ethical sanctification or process within it. What is it about Jesus that brings us into a communion with the Father, where the language of union, reunion, and that we understand Jesus today, not one merely who is distant, who's acted for us, we live in those benefits, and that our worship isn't merely separate, but that the very act of who Jesus is in our modern Christology is a kind of a middle that isn't still all about the human, but really is Jesus as the one through whom we come to know the Father. And I didn't hear that piece in any one of the positions, that the significant role that John particularly has, and it just raised the question of Jesus as the expression of the Trinitarian life of
God. Yeah, thanks. Of course, it was a long paper anyway, and things that had to remain on the cutting room floor. I think that the Gospel of John is giving us a high Christology, you know, precisely along the terms that you suggest. Remember, the key category, as I'm interpreting it, for biblical Christology is spirituality. And the Gospel of John is not about Jesus just giving us the same spirit, and that's our salvation. You know, it's the Spirit who brings Christ to us and us to Christ, and in bringing us to Christ, brings us into union with Christ, so that Christ can bring us to the Father in and through his own person. So yes, union with Christ and participatio Christi, and that priestly move that goes from a below to above, so that we're joined to Christ and sanctified through our union with him, so that we can become presentable through his sacrifice to the Father. That presupposes a high view of Christ's person and a high view of his work, especially in its priestly intercessory aspect. So the Spirit all the way through plays a role in keeping our focus on Christ. In the Gospel of John, the Spirit bears witness to Christ and the truth of Christ. The Spirit implicitly is the one who brings us into union with Christ, so that we get all that language in chapters 13 through 17 that kind of focuses around the preposition in. It's amazing how much work the New Testament can get out of the preposition in, and, you know, the Father in me, and I in him, and we in you, and so on. It's the Spirit who mediates all those relations of participation that are signaled by the word in. I would understand the Spirit as the mediator of communion, as I've written about elsewhere. And the Spirit is the communion, but it's communion with the Father through the Son, we could say succinctly. So you just could not say that In a way, middle Christologies, at least in their pure form, tend to eliminate the mediation of Christ in that priestly movement. It's kind of directly between us and the Father, you might say, mediated by the Spirit, as opposed to in the Spirit through the Son to the Father. So the mediation of the Son is indispensable for a high Christology, but low Christologies tend not to think in those terms, in middle. Can you hear him? Somehow the mic's not picking up.
Check. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your paper. It was very enlightening. I've never read Schleiermacher before, and I find him to be fascinating. So I have a clarifying question about his three categories of empirical, magical, and mystical. For the magical, you used a term objective, that the atonement would be objective. Do you mean by objective something like mechanistic, that if we have a certain input, then a certain output is expected?
Well, Schleiermacher would probably think of it as mechanistic, but that would be a kind of defective view. It's just that something happens apart from us in Christ's obedience, in our place and for our sakes. And there's nothing mechanistic about this, that it all takes place in the Spirit. But his saving obedience has a substitutionary and intercessory aspect that is completed and finished before it comes to us. You see, whereas for Schleiermacher and the middle type, depending on the repetition of the spirituality, you know, that spirituality has to be repeated in us for salvation to take place. That's the event of salvation. Whereas for a high Christology, as I'm interpreting it, the crucial thing about the saving work of Christ is precisely that it's unrepeatable. It's finished. It occurs apart from us, in our place, and then comes to us as a pure gift.
Okay.
So objective doesn't have to mean mechanistic.
Okay.
It just has to mean that the decisive work of salvation takes place extra nos. Something has to take place in nobis too, but that's secondary and consequential. It's not definitive and constitutive of Christ's saving significance. So the way I'm interpreting the middle group is, you know, all Christologies, whether they use this terminology or not, in effect have to have some account of what takes place objectively and some account of what takes subjectively, even though it's sometimes simplified out and oversimplified that high Christologies are merely objectivist and middle Christologies are merely subjective and experiential. No, that's not true. That's why I tried to say that for Schleiermacher, Jesus has the role of the prologue. But see, that spirituality has to have taken place in him first. That's an objective moment, so to speak, but it's all on the spiritual, quote-unquote, subjective level. I mean, he has to have a kind of spiritual breakthrough. He has to live a life of perfect communion with God. He has to be transparent to the ground of being. He has to have a perfect God consciousness. He has to maintain faith, whatever it is, even to the end. He's constantly undergoing tests and trials. This is essentially an Antiochian scheme. You'll find this in Theodore of Mopsuestia. He's constantly overcoming temptations and trials more than temptations, to maintain that spiritual bond with God. But the cross doesn't have the character of expiation. You know, it's not where sin is done away with and where death is defeated, as Schleiermacher insists for his middle view. That has to take place in us, or not at all. So that's a decisive difference. And that's why the high Christology, as I'm interpreting it, can present Jesus to us as a pure gift, and not from the standpoint of moral rigorism, or not from the standpoint of having to have something happen in us on which salvation depends. Of course, from a high Christological standpoint, it's not complete. It doesn't reach its fulfillment until it reaches us and changes our lives. But that's not what defines the essence of salvation. What defines salvation is Christ bearing our sins away and defeating death, which he does apart from us before he comes to us as a gift.
Okay.
Is that
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi. Can you clarify your use of the terms high and low in relation to the terms Christology from above and Christology from below? And what I'm thinking mainly is, can one do a Christology from below that might be categorized as high Christology in your terms?
Yeah, I'd like to know the origin of those terms, you know, Christology from above, Christology from below. I find them to be singularly unilluminating. I just don't think they add any analytical clarity. It's sort of, how do we get the idea that Jesus is God? You know, do we get it from below? Well, what would that mean? You know, is it a matter of inference? You know, he's so fully human that he had to be God? That sort of thing? Or that if you think he's God incarnate, that's a Christology from above? No, I mean, he's revealed to us as fully God and fully human at one and the same time through the apostolic witness as we find it in the New Testament. I mean, it's neither from above nor from below. It has high and low, or, you know, divine and human aspects, but neither one is an inference from the other. It's not from above to below. It's not from below to above. This is a kind of a modernistic quandary of how we get to some view of Jesus, you know, and if you want to dismiss the idea that Jesus is fully God, you might opt for Christology from below as a preferable option. But then do you really ever get to Jesus as fully God? They might say, well, if you operate from above, do you get to Jesus as fully human? Well, if you start with the New Testament, you get both right away. Jesus is fully God and fully human, both in the Synoptic Gospels and in the Johannine Gospel. But I think from reversed perspectives, I think the Synoptic Gospels put the humanity of Jesus in the forefront, and his deity is there. I mean, after all, think about how Mark opens in chapter 2 with Jesus forgiving the sins of the man lowered through the roof, and the objection is raised right away. Where does he get the authority to forgive sins? And, you know, he walks on water in the Gospel of Mark, which is a theophany story. His humanity is in the forefront. It's reversed in the Gospel of John. You know, the divine elements are there in Mark, but the human element is in the forefront. In John, it's kind of the reverse. You know, there's no doubt of this high, exalted Jesus. You know, Kaiserman said Jesus sails through life like a ship on the ocean, you know, untroubled by any human suffering or conflicts. You know, that's an oversimplification. But the emphasis in John is clearly from the standpoint of presentation. You might say the rhetoric of it, more than the substance of it, is the deity of Christ is there from the prologue on to Thomas's confession, you know, my Lord and my God, and the humanity is put in the background. I think we need both sorts of depiction, but neither of those goes from below to above. It's perspectival.
I was just wondering if you could maybe articulate a bit of how high, middle, and low Christologies affect the church and how the church views itself, what the ministry of the church ought to be, and how the church might relate to a Christology from high, middle, and low perspective.
Well, I think on the whole, low and middle Christologies are modern Christologies. I mean, they have roots in certain ancient trends. Low and middle Christologies tend to have their roots in the Antiochene rather than the Alexandrian tradition. And as I say in a footnote about Burkhoff, many modern Christologies tend to be Nestorian in their Christology and modalistic in their doctrines of the Trinity. And, you know, more recently, you know, some Catholic theologians have embraced a form of middle Christology. You know, liberationists have a strong ethical element, but because they're Catholics, they can't let go of Chalcedon. You know, they would get into more trouble even than they're in if they did that. So they don't dispute the high view of the Incarnation. They just don't make it do that priestly intercessory work or that work of Christ as the victor over the powers that are hostile to God and that enslave us. You know, I think priestly and royal elements can be done justice to in a high Christology. I don't know how low and middle Christologies think. It's a question. I'm sure we would get types of views. Let's say, how do they think about the sacraments? How do they think about the Lord's Supper? You know, in a low Christology, you might think the Lord's Supper becomes a way in which we have fellowship with one another. You know, I see this in the Presbyterian Church or the Reformed tradition sometimes. It's all sort of horizontal, you know, not much vertical. You know, it's probably not true to the best of Swingli, but there's a Swinglian element in that. You know, middle Christology, well, it would be a way, yet again, for that spirituality, whatever we call it, you know, God consciousness, new being, maybe just faith or loyalty, or could be, you know, its names are legion, you know, but I'm using the term spirituality as a kind of covering concept, which is kind of unique to the way I'm presenting this Christology. How the sacraments would have to be thought out in those terms. Even in Protestant versions of high Christology, as I suggested with my remark about Bart, you don't necessarily get what I would now regard with my work in the ecumenical movement as an adequate emphasis that Christian worship is by definition Eucharistic worship. I mean, I think any truly Christian form of worship with roots in the historic tradition would not see the Lord's Supper as a kind of option that you have sometime, you know, maybe if you're lucky, once a month, or maybe once a quarter, or maybe once a year, and you know, and it's such a high and fearful thing, even if it's once a year, you know, out on the far islands of Scotland, you might be too afraid to come forward and approach this holy mystery. No, I once wrote an email asking a Russian Orthodox theologian a question about worship. Is when I was working on my book, The Eucharist and Ecumenism, Gavrilik, who wrote on the suffering of the impassible God. I asked him a question of worship, and he wrote back with an answer about the Eucharist. And that was really illuminating to me. I mean, worship to him meant Eucharist, and you know, I am at the point where I think that's correct. So it would be sort of ecclesiologically defective if you have a high Christology with person and work, but don't connect it to the centrality of the Eucharist. You get the centrality of the Eucharist with a Florovsky. See, with representatives who come out of the high sacramental churches, you know, with a von Balthasar. But then do you get a robust enough emphasis on mission? In Eastern Orthodox churches, by and large, certainly not. You know, or ethics, even. You know, the vertical takes over. Balthasar doesn't, as far as I know, have much of a sense of mission and opposing the forces of death and the culture of death in a society, and not in a limited way focused on one or two issues, but in an age of impending nuclear catastrophe and ecological suicide and so on, the church needs to have a profile of public responsibility in the public realm. And by and large, it's the low Christologies, and maybe the middle Christologies, that do the heavy lifting here. So they play a role. They compensate for the defects of high people who hold high Christologies and don't carry it through in their confidence in Jesus Christ crucified and risen and the Lord of life and of death. So that's why I think all Christologies need to learn from whether at least to the point of not caricaturing one another, which I hope I haven't done. And high Christologies need to take on board a great deal that low and middle Christologies have to offer. And one of the reasons they exist is because high Christologies haven't done so. I think, again, Latin America is really a case in point. You have a Catholic Church with a high view of Christ's person, at least, but it's in league with the oppressors. And so it leads to this reaction over against it, which is a kind of a necessary reaction for all its distortion effects of picking up on something that has been sorely neglected by those who are otherwise, in some ways, theologically orthodox.
Thanks. Actually begin to answer my question that I had in this last part of your response to that previous question. I was just kind of curious about the applicability of the typology to something like Eucharistic theology, and trying to categorize perhaps differing perspectives in the history of the church according to high, middle, and low, and the like. And wondering if you could make some sort of application of your P person, therefore W work. Could you even have a therefore E Eucharist? You began to kind of like gesture towards that a little bit. But I wonder if these connections are sort of necessary connections, or if they're more sort of like family resemblances, or you tend to have high Eucharistic theology with high Christology, but that's not necessary because you could have a high Christology but a low Eucharistic theology, just as you could have sort of a high Christology and a low sort of atonement theory, so to speak. So maybe just could you spell a little bit more what the connection might be between sort of a Eucharistic theology and those Christologies you gesture towards?
Yeah, good. Thanks, a good question. It's one thing to think about what's logically possible, right? So lots of things might be logically possible. But what is normatively and biblically required? You know, that would be finally the question. And of course, the doctrinal questions about the Eucharist are, you know, very difficult. It's a big can of worms, and it's, you know, the sacrament of unity has become the point of division throughout the history of the church. I have a whole book on this called The Eucharist, right. The Eucharist and Ecumenism, Let Us Keep the Feast. Mm-hmm. And I'm a delegate to the official Reformed Roman Catholic International Dialogue where we take up these things. But I in the book, I try to show how all traditions can move toward one another without theological compromise. But each tradition has to understand that it needs to accept some things it thought it had to reject. And you can accept these things without theological compromise. And I do it as a Reformed theologian from the standpoint of Reformed theology. Actually, as I say it toward the beginning of the book, and I've kind of gotten kicked for this by some people, but it's actually not a statement about objective states of affairs. It's a statement about my own inabilities. I didn't know how to deal with the broad Free Church Anabaptist traditions. But in Free Church traditions, like say Mennonites, they may or may not hold to Chalcedons. I mean, they may have a kind of aversion to traditional conciliar decisions. But ecumenically, I just think it's a disaster if we think that it's a scandal that cries out to heaven that the church should be so divided when the church is one and needs to manifest visible unity in the world for the sake of the integrity of its witness to Christ, that they may all be one, as we read in John 17. With this fragmentation, which was introduced into the world through Protestantism, essentially. I mean, there have been divisions, but there hasn't been this splintering until Protestantism. I mean, on the negative side, you know, Protestantism is synonymous with fragmentation, and the Catholic Church is synonymous with centralization and authoritarian policies, and they can't hold their own priests accountable for child abuse, for crying out loud. I mean, this is absolutely scandalous. Read Gary Will's Forgive Not. You can find that online. And there's a Catholic voice that has the proper sense of moral outrage. It's related to their hierarchy. And, you know, as much as I love Eastern Orthodoxy and have learned from them, they stand for ossification on the negative side. They just can't adapt. I asked an Orthodox priest one time if he thought they would ever ordain women. He said, "Oh, I'm sure we will in about 300 or 400 years. You know, they don't move slowly, quickly enough. You know, so we all have our defects, which to me says you stay where you are and try to work from there. The grass is not greener somewhere else. It's just a different set of problems. But I think, both on material grounds and on pragmatic grounds, that a high view of the Eucharist, which means the real presence of the body and blood of Christ in, with, and under the consecrated elements. I think you can say that. You couldn't say that in 16th century as a Reformed theologian. I give reasons why I think you can say that today as a Reformed theologian. You have to have a view of Eucharistic sacrifice. There are areas, those are areas where we have things to learn, and we have a lot to learn from the Orthodox. Vatican II decided that from a Roman Catholic standpoint, there are no objections in principle, this has to be stated carefully, no objections in principle to Eucharistic sharing with the Orthodox. That's huge, because the Catholics and the Orthodox don't agree on a large number of questions, and particularly on questions where Protestants could not agree with Catholics, for example, on transubstantiation, but they could agree with the Orthodox on their views of Eucharistic conversion. And then I have a whole argument for how the an Orthodox view called transelementation is different from transubstantiation and is open to Protestants and was known by 16th century reformers like Peter Martyr Vermeely and Thomas Cranmer and Martin Bucer and not rejected. They didn't make it central, but that's part of my argument of something you could accept without theological compromise because they saw nothing wrong with it theologically. It's possible that even Calvin knew that view. And if that's correct in the passage where he talks about it in the Institutes, he concludes by saying, to this we have no objection. So they don't take it on board, but we need to take it on board if we're serious about moving toward overcoming the scandal of a divided church and especially of a church in which we can't share in one another's Eucharist. Mm-hmm. And you know, while I'm on this topic, you might think, there's one guy who responded to my book who said, well, we have Eucharistic sharing all over the place in my wing of the church. Well, that's fine. You know, it's a free church tradition. They don't have any barriers for themselves. Everybody thinks if only the rest of the church would become like us, it would solve all our ecumenical problems. Back when there were 6 million people in the world, it's more like 7 million today. I don't have the full statistics anymore. But back when there were 6 billion people, there were 2 billion Christians. Now that's something worth keeping in mind. Half of them are Roman Catholics. So I mean, we're not in the 16th century anymore, Toto. You know, I mean, the Reformation did not prevail in world Christianity. The Roman Catholic Church is the world's oldest and the world's largest institution. The Orthodox are as old, but they're not as large. There are 15 to 20% more of that piece of the pie that would be Orthodox. So that's 65, maybe 70% of the world's Christians belong to high sacramental traditions. I mean, these are pragmatic considerations, but they're not inconsiderable. I mean, we're not going to transform these high sacramental churches into the theology of the Reformation, at least not overnight. You know, we've had a shot at it. You know, I'm a Presbyterian minister. I'm part of the Reformed tradition. Do you know what percentage? I mean, I'm not talking about all of Protestantism. Just the Reformed tradition is, at best, 1%. 1% of the world's Christians are from the Reformed tradition. So, I mean, think of that piece of the pie, you know, and carve out that 1% there. I mean, that's small. Well, I mean, in a way, it shows the strength of the Reformed tradition. We've produced a lot of very significant theologians, you know, maybe as much as any other tradition, except the Catholics and to some degree the Orthodox. But I mean, when you think of the names, the glorious names in the pantheon of Reformed theology, it's quite considerable. We're almost like the Jews, you know. We have influence beyond our numbers. We're sort of intellectuals. But we're only 1% at best. And do you know how many different Reformed denominations there are within that 1%? They did a survey toward the end of the 20th century in Geneva. Even Lukas Fischer, the great Reformed ecumenical statesperson, was surprised to learn that there are 750 different Reformed denominations, and it's more today than it was then. So take that little sliver of 1%. And imagine a Japanese cook with a meat cleaver. You're going, you know, getting your 750 pieces. I mean, it's fragment. They're in communion with one another, but it shows the problem of fragmentation in the whole Protestant movement. And, you know, then you had the Lutherans, okay, you had the Episcopalians and the Anglicans, you had the Baptists, you know, they're, you know, how many different forms of Baptist are, you know, I mean, I still don't know what a hard-shell Baptist is, but, you know, Abraham Lincoln was a hard-shell Baptist at one point. I mean, what is this? And then Pentecostalism, you know, we don't even have statistics for them, but, you know, it's not just one thing. You know, and the charismatics differentiate themselves into becoming, and we don't know where they're going. They're such a young movement. You know, some of it will be Christocentric and Trinitarian, but not all of it will, it seems, you know, especially in the way it works out in third world countries, a lot of syncretism, you know, blessing briefcases in Brazil and so on. I mean, you know, what is this stuff? You know, it doesn't look like Christianity in any classical form that I can recognize. A lot of it does, but, you know, some of it doesn't. So you get outside the sacramental traditions where they can have some kind of control over the limits to diversity. I mean, it's not that they're just homogenous, but you know, they have more or less a unified liturgy. They have a polity, which means bishops. I'm sorry to tell you, if you're Protestant. I mean, it means bishops, not bishops as we know them, I argue in my Eucharist book. It has to be some different form of accountability, and you know, it's what we have to offer, is some form of popular influence and decision-making power from the faithful, the sensus fidelium. But a high Christology needs to be connected to a high ecclesiology that can prevent fragmentation and still be flexible and still respond to the needs of the world in which we live. So yeah, if P then W and if W then E, but when you throw that in, it just puts a spotlight on the shortfalls of every tradition, you know, and the partial character of it, I think. So maybe one of the advantages of my sort of helicopter view of looking at the landscape is that you can begin to see the relative strengths and weaknesses of actually existing Christologies in relation to ecclesiologies. But I think that a recovery of the centrality of Eucharistic worship so that, you know, not at the expense of the word, I mean, actually Vatican II has instituted a very strong liturgy of a liturgy of the word followed by a liturgy of the sacrament. I saw this done in Italy one time, and the service of the word went on for quite a while. I mean, it left nothing to be desired from an evangelical point of view. I mean, it was a lot of scripture reading. It was actually a sermon based on scripture, and then they celebrated the Eucharist. And that's what they did every Sunday.